Hello students, welcome to these discussions on finite element methods. In this video we shall see the discussions on one dimensional analysis and its application problems. To start with, we'll see the potential energy approach, how it is applied for derivation of element stiffness matrix, then assembly of global stiffness matrix, then derivation of element body force vector, then derivation of element traction force vector, followed by the equilibrium equation KQ is equal to F, and we'll move to the further derivations. Now let us see, in entire FEM we are using the displacement approach. Our approach is displacement approach. Therefore, once we say displacement, then the load multiplied by perpendicular distance, that will lead to the work done terms. And because of those displacements, even we know what are the strain energy stored within the element, right, or within the entire structure, right? That is how we'll use the potential energy approach for getting the displacement, unknown displacement. Our entire approach in all the discussions further is only potential energy approach, right? Not the not weighted residual approach, right? Now let us see, if I want to apply that potential energy approach, I'm just recalling, I'll not use variational approach now. Even I'll demonstrate that using variational approach also, but we are there now in potential energy approach. There the potential energy of that continuum, we already seen that pi is equal to the strain energy half integration over entire volume sigma transpose epsilon multiplied by dv plus work potential is the work done by the body forces, integration over v u transpose f dv, and also minus u transpose t ds over entire integration s, work done by the traction forces, and work done by the concentrated loads, if any, summation of ui pis, if any. That is how the work done terms, these are the three work done terms, work done by all the three types of forces: element body forces, element traction forces, concentrated loads, if any. Similarly, if at all temperature loads are also there, they will also come into picture. Here to start with, I am not emphasizing on the temperature loads, they will also come in the later discussions, fine. Then once we have the element potential energy for a continuum given by this, now I can say, because we already discretized into n number of elements, then I can say that that continuum which is having n number of elements is now written as summation over all such elements. I can write for one element, what is the strain energy? Half entire over entire element sigma transpose epsilon multiplied by a multiplied by dx, because dv is nothing but a multiplied by dx, minus u transpose f dv is nothing but a multiplied by dx over one element. Similarly, u transpose t, where t is the in terms of newton per mm load per unit length, right? Load intensity, t, so many newton per mm, right? That is how u transpose t multiplied by dx. Students, please note that it is dx, not ds. Then over all such elements, and the work done by the concentrated loads, if any, ui pis, if at all they are there, right? It acting at different nodes for one element. Like that, you take summation over all such elements, that will give the strain energy of that continuum. This is for one element only. Therefore, over such all elements means for the continuum, I'll get the potential energy of that continuum, of that continuum, 1D continuum, one dimensional problem. Now let us consider the potential energy is summation over all such elements ue minus summation of all such elements u transpose f dv summation of all such elements u transpose t dx, summation of all such elements ui pi's. Now this first term is what, the strain energy in each element, right? Now I'll move to the derivation of element stiffness matrix ke, for which I'll recall this first term, strain energy term. I'm just having this strain energy in one element. Students, please make a note. I hope you are understanding. For one element we are deriving, right? For one element, right? UE is equal to half integration over 0 to LE, length of that element, sigma transpose epsilon multiplied by dv. But dv is equal to a multiplied by dx. And we also know this relationship that dxi is nothing but 2 divided by LE multiplied by dx. Hence, dx is equal to LE by 2 multiplied by dxi. That is how the relation between local and global coordinate systems, but all that is differentiated, I'll get this dx is equal to LE by 2 multiplied by dxi, right? Now, once I get this, we already know that epsilon is equal to b multiplied by q. Hence, half minus 1 to plus 1, this is there in the global coordinate system, students. X is equal to 0 to L is there in the global coordinate system. Now, I am transforming that into local coordinate system. Please see, that is all right. Therefore, X is equal to 0 in local coordinate system is having the left node is having xi as minus 1. That X is equal to L in the local coordinate system is having a numeric value of xi is equal to plus 1. That is how the limits have changed. X is equal to 0 to L, you have changed. Xi is equal to minus 1 to plus 1. That is how the transformation is happening. Right? And sigma transpose. Sigma is nothing but E multiplied by epsilon. Right? That is all. Then. And epsilon is nothing but BQ. And so, what now we'll do is BQ. And so, using that, sigma is equal to E multiplied by epsilon. Sigma transpose means E transpose, epsilon transpose, but E transpose is not, E is not a matrix nor a vector here. E is a constant. Therefore, E transpose itself is E, just a constant, right? It is not a vector, right? But E multiplied by epsilon. Epsilon is a vector. Therefore, a vector can be transposed. Yes. Therefore, sigma transpose is nothing but epsilon transpose multiplied by E. But we already know that epsilon is equal to BQ. Therefore, substituting that, epsilon is equal to BQ. Therefore, epsilon transpose is nothing but Q transpose multiplied by B transpose. That multiplied by Young's modulus multiplied by this epsilon is nothing but B multiplied by Q. That is how these two terms are now written here up to this. Then multiplied by dv. dv is nothing but area multiplied by dx, area. But dx is nothing but LE by 2 dxi. That is how I've substituted. Means I've just transformed this strain energy from global coordinate system to local coordinate system. Please understand this point, students. Fine. I hope you're understanding. I'm writing that strain energy, right? In terms of local coordinate system here. Previously, it was there in the global coordinate system, right? However, the strain energy is immaterial of the coordinate system. It is the same. That. Now, this equation UE can be written in a standard format. Element stiffness matrix can always be written. This strain energy can always be written in standard format as UE is equal to half Q transpose multiplied by KE multiplied by Q. You please see this relationship can also be always be written in standard format as half Q transpose KE multiplied by Q. Now I'm doing that half. I'm taking this Q outside of integration because that is a constant. It doesn't depend upon the integration, right? Then what are the terms that are left inside are now B transpose EB. And A, LE by 2 multiplied by DXI. These are the terms that are left. If I take that Q outside, because even Q is a constant that can be taken out of integration. That is how within integration these terms are left. Within integration, these terms are left, right? That is how it is written in standard format. U is equal to half Q transpose KE multiplied by Q students, right? Where this within bracket is what called element stiffness matrix. Element stiffness matrix KE, which is varying from minus 1 to plus 1, or varying from minus 1 to plus 1, given by B transpose, E multiplied by BAE, LE by 2. Students, I hope you are understanding, right? That LE by 2 multiplied by DXI. This is what element stiffness matrix. Then, let us further evaluate or integrate it and see what's the final result. Then, please make a note that I already told that B is a constant matrix. It doesn't depend upon integration. It is having only constant term. What is that B? Is nothing but 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1. It is a constant matrix, right? Okay. That can also be taken out of integration. And Young's modulus is constant. It can be taken out of integration. And B is a constant. It can be taken out of integration. And area of the element and length of the element. All these terms being constant, they are not influenced by the integration. They are not position dependent on xi coordinate system. Hence, all they are taken out of integration. Only what is now left within integration is minus 1 to plus 1 integration dxi. But doing that, now I'll get dxi means xi 1 minus half minus plus 1 means 2. Therefore, that now becomes B transpose E B A multiplied by LE. This is nothing but volume. Area of the element AE multiplied by LE is volume. Therefore, element shiftness matrix KE. KE is nothing but B transpose E B VE. Volume of the element, right? Volume of the element. Now let us further expand this in the form of substituting what is B. What is B is already 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1. Hence, B transpose is nothing but 1 by LE minus 1, 1. It's a transpose is 2 by 1 vector where B is 1 by 2 matrix. 1 by 2 matrix. Therefore, doing that, now I'll get this AEL 1 by L minus 1, 1 operated upon 1 by L minus 1, 1. 1 by 2 matrix, right? Therefore, 2 by 1 matrix is operated upon 1 by 2 matrix leading to 2 by 2 matrix, leading to 2 by 2. You please see A, E, L, L, E, L, E gets cancelled. The denominator L, L, E is there. Therefore, A, E by L, minus 1 multiplied by minus 1, plus 1, right? Minus 1 multiplied by plus 1, minus 1, this. 1 multiplied by minus 1, minus 1, and 1 multiplied by 1 is equal to plus 1. That is our 2 by 2. Hence, we derived element shiftness matrix given by AE by L 1 minus 1 minus 1 1, which is 2 by 2 matrix, is what called element shiftness matrix of 1D two noded element, where AE by L is what called axial stiffness. Now I'll move to the next derivation, students, right? I hope you are understanding, right? All these derivations are being done using local coordinate system, right? Using local coordinate system. Now I move to the derivation of element body force vector, students, right? Which is notated by FE, element body force vector. Now I'll take the very first term of the work potential given by U transpose F multiplied by dV, but dV is equal to A multiplied by dx over entire volume. But I'm considering only one element. Therefore, for one element, it is given by integration over element length L, U transpose F A dx, where x is equal to 0 to L, 0 to L, right? That is of lower bound and upper bound. And so U transpose F A dx, where F is what? The density of the material, sulfate intensity, so many kiloton per meter cube, or newton per mm cube, or pound per inch cube, or pound per feet cube, right, as appropriate, right? Therefore, however, we already know that U is equal to NQ. Therefore, U is equal to NQ. Substituting that, now I'll get U transpose is nothing but Q transpose multiplied by N transpose. But Q is also a matrix, N is also a matrix. Therefore, both should be transposed. Therefore, U is equal to NQ. It's a transpose is equal to Q transpose multiplied by N transpose. Integration over 0 to L, Q transpose, N transpose, F A dx. Now, it can be written. It can be written like this, right? And now I'll substitute dx is equal to le by 2 multiplied by dx. Previously, this is there in global coordinate system, 0 to L. Now I'll transform that to the local coordinate system using that local global correspondence. And it's 1 to plus 1, Q transpose, N transpose, F, A, dx is le by 2 multiplied by dx. Once I'm changing that x, lower bound 0 will become minus 1, upper bound x is equal to L will become xi is equal to plus 1. That is how the transformation is done from local coordinate system to global coordinate system. But this Q transpose is constant. It can be taken out of integration. Now I'll write this in the standard format, that Q transpose multiplied by Fe, where Fe is what called element body force vector. Once I take Q transpose out of this integration, what are the terms that are left are written here. But out of that also, this F, density of the material, is constant. That can be taken out of integration. And volume, area multiplied by length, which is the volume, is also constant. It can also be taken out of integration. 1 by 2 is also constant, taken out of integration. Only now what is left within integration is integration minus 1 to plus 1, N1, N2, dxi. N1, N2, dxi. Because N transpose, not N1, N2, row matrix, is a column matrix, N1, N2, dxi, students, right? It is not minus N1, N2, it is just N1, N2, right? Dxi. Therefore, once we say this, because N1 depends upon xi, because N1 is equal to 1 minus xi by 2, N2 is equal to 1 plus xi by 2, they cannot be taken out of integration. Previously, they are taken out of integration because they were constants. But N1, N2 cannot be taken out of integration because they themselves are functions of local coordinate system xi. Now I'll substitute that. N1 is equal to minus 1 by xi, 1 minus xi by 2, and N2 is equal to 1 plus xi by 2, students. Doing which, now I'll get, I'll just move quickly, that minus 1 to plus 1, 1 minus xi by 2, integration by parts to individual coefficients. That is how it is shown, by parts to individual, integration over minus 1 to plus 1, 1 minus xi by 2, dxi, minus 1 to plus 1, 1 plus xi by 2, multiplied by dxi. Integration of this first N1 leads to half xi minus xi square by 2, minus 1 to plus 1. Similarly, integration of the N2 leads to 1 by 2 xi plus xi square divided by 2, minus 1 to plus 1. Substituting lower bound and upper bound, I can see that half multiplied by this will become 2, 2 gets cancelled, leading to 1 value. Even similarly, this leads to integration, substituting lower bound or upper bound, half multiplied by 2 leads to 1, right? That is how now I do have this term within this bracket is equal to first term, second term, 1 and 1. Then we'll say that element body force vector, which is 2 by 1 vector notated by Fe, is nothing but FAL divided by 2. F is nothing but so many density, so many kiloton per meter cube, kiloton per meter cube multiplied by volume meter cube, or newton per mm cube multiplied by mm cube volume, or inch cube, pound per inch cube, as appropriate, right? Therefore, that is how F density multiplied by volume, that entire weight of the structure, or weight of that element. Now structure is now only one element I have considered, student, right? There is only one element. It's a weight, right? It's a weight which is acting at the CG, will be distributed half to the first node, will be distributed half to the second node. That is what the meaning of this element body force vector, right? Half of the load, right? F multiplied by volume multiplied by 1 by 2, 1 by 2 means half of the load will go to the first node, half of the self weight will go to the second node. That is already known, right? If a unit self weight is acting at the CG of this element, students, then half the load will go to the first node, half the load will go to the second node as reaction. Hence, that is how the meaning F A L by 2, 1, 1 means F A L half, half. This one means half, half. Half the load will go to the first node, half the load will go to the second node. That is how the meaning of contribution to the first and second node, which is element body force vector. Now let us see in a quick fashion the derivation of element traction force vector, now which is notated by T to the subscript E. Now I'll recall the work done by the traction forces as per unit length. Please make a note, it is per unit length, 0 to L integration over 0 to L U transpose T multiplied by dx. This is per unit length, students. Then we already know dx is equal to L A by 2 multiplied by dxi. This is the work done by the traction forces in global coordinate system being transformed to local coordinate system as minus 1 to plus 1 Q transpose N transpose T L A by 2 dxi, where U is equal to N cube. Therefore, U transpose is equal to Q transpose multiplied by N transpose. It can be shown in the standard format as Q transpose multiplied by TE, where TE is element traction force vector, which is T. Here T is a constant actually. So many Newton per mm, maybe 5 Newton per mm, right? That phi can be taken out of integration, and LE by 2 is also constant taken out of integration. But what is only left within integration is N transpose multiplied by dxi. Because N depends upon the xi, it is dependent upon the position. N transpose multiplied by dxi, they are there inside of integration. But we already seen in the previous discussion that integration of N1 is equal to 1, integration of N2 is also 1. I'm substituting the same here. It leads to element traction force vector as TL by 2, 1, 1 means TL half, half. Is also self understood that if intensity of the UDL, let us say some T Newton per mm, is acting over this entire length L, right? Half the load will go to the first node, half the load will go to the second node. That is a self-explanatory. This T multiplied by L is a total load, will be distributed as 1 by 2 to the first node, as 1 by 2 to the second node. That is the meaning of element traction force vector. That is the contribution of this surface traction force to the first and second nodes respectively, right? Then once I write this, then what I'll do is from the element stiffness matrices, now I'll assemble the global stiffness matrix. Global stiffness matrix from small ke element stiffness matrix. I'll assemble the global stiffness matrix as summation for all such ke's is equal to capital K. And from all these element body force vectors, element traction force vectors, and concentrated loads, if any, for each and every element, I'll assemble them using local global correspondence for all such elements to write the global load vector F. Global load vector F. Therefore, using these notations, now I'll say that the potential energy pi is given by half capital Q transpose. Capital is in the global phenomena, structural displacement matrix, or simply displacement vector multiplied by capital K means structural stiffness matrix or global stiffness matrix multiplied by Q minus Q. This is the strain energy term plus work potential. Plus work potential means minus Q transpose multiplied by F. F is a global load vector. Global load vector, right? Global load vector. This is for the entire structure, students. Cap is pi in terms of capital Q, capital K, capital F is for the entire structure, for all the elements, right? Please make a note, right? Now, let us see the next subheading as assembly of global stiffness matrix, how to assemble, right? We already know, this is the heading, assembly of global stiffness matrix. We already know that cross-section 1D problem, which was having varying cross-section, which was modeled using stepped bar, which was discretized into finite number of elements. For that, now I'll say that using the element connectivity table, K1 is equal to A1 E1 by L1, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1 along that degree of freedoms. From element connectivity table, you can see these degrees of freedoms. This first element is connected with global degrees of freedoms 192, 192. That is how the meaning. This first element is related with the global degrees of freedoms 192, 192. That is the meaning of this horizontal 192, 192, right? Row 192, right? That is how K1 is. But here, for the entire problem, E is constant, students. Therefore, because of that, now we can write E as a constant in all this. Hence, so only areas are different, A1, A2 dash dash up to A5. And their lengths are also different. L1, L2 dash dash up to. If at all, this is having different Young's moduli, E1, E2, E3, then you can put E1, E2 dash dash up to EN. Then that is how means here FEM can also be used for solving such problems, means varying materials, not only varying cross section but also varying materials, E1 E2 E3, right? That is how here we are considering homogeneous material. Here, students, homogeneous elastic material means E is constant, homogeneous, Young's modulus is not changing from one element to another element, homogeneous problem, right? Then that is what called with different Young's moduli, heterogeneous, right? First material is different, second element is different, right? That is how, right? Heterogeneous, or with varying Young's moduli, right? That is how E is constant. E is equal to E1 is equal to E2 is equal to dash dash up to E5. Hence K1 is equal to A1 E divided by L1, 1 minus 1 minus 1 along the global degrees of freedoms 1 2 1 2, right? Similarly, in cyclic fashion, you can write k2 is equal to a2e divided by l2, 1 minus 1 minus 1 along the degrees of freedoms 2 3 2 3 2 3 2 3. These 2 3 2 3 are noted from element connectivity table. Please see that second element is connected between the global degrees of freedom 2 3 2 3. That is how you write. I think so on and so forth. You can write for the third, fourth, and fifth as A3E divided by L3, 1 minus 1, minus 1, right? Dash dash up to last one, right? K5. A5E divided by L5, 1 minus 1, 1 along 5 6 5 6. Here, 5 6 5 6, right? That is how element stiffness matrices are written. But what is global stiffness matrix, students? It is summation of all such elements. All such elements. Now I do have five elements, and the six nodes are there. Five elements will have six nodes. Therefore, six degrees of freedoms are possible because each node can displace in x direction by 1 degree of freedom. 1 degree of freedom. That is how six nodes will have 6 degrees of freedom. 6 degrees of freedom. Therefore, the element stiffness global stiffness matrix, which is notated by capital K, its size is equal to capital N by capital N, where N is the total degrees of freedoms, 6 degrees of freedoms by 6 degrees of freedom. Now you, which is summation over all such elements, E is equal to 1 to 5, 5 elements only. Now you open a big matrix with 6 rows, right, like this, and 6 columns. Therefore, we do have 36 coefficients. Within that 6 by 6 means 36 coefficients are there, right? Now you write first row, leave some space, second row, third, fourth, so on and so, sixth row, right? Like that you write first column, second column, so on and so forth, six column. Or you may open an Excel sheet of 6x6 size, a matrix of 6x6 size in Excel sheet also as a property. If you are doing a mathematical programming, right? Mathematical programming, right? You can open an Excel sheet of 6x6, akin to that, right? Therefore, now let us see what is that element shiftness matrix K1. K1 is having the constant A1E divided by L1 multiplied by 1. That is a constant actually. There is a coefficient. This need to be written in the global position as in the first row, first column. This is there in the first row, first column. This coefficient, right? Therefore, I'm just going the IP address of this 6x6 matrix is there. The IP address is first row, first column. I'm there in the first row, first column IP address. This is the first row, first column. There. By taking Young's modulus as constant outside, I'll bring the other terms as coefficients, right? Therefore, that is how A1 by L1 is the coefficient. E is also there outside, right? Therefore, A1E divided by L1, E is taken outside. A1E. Now, similarly, I'll go to the first row, second column, right? First row, second column is having this IP address is having a coefficient of A1E by L1 multiplied by 1, means minus A1E divided by L1. By taking E outside, I can write that first row, second column, minus A1E divided by L1. E taken outside in of this box, right? That is all. Similarly, you do. Now I'll go to the second row, first column. This is having a coefficient of minus A1 by L1 multiplied by E. Similarly, I'll go to second row, second column. This 1 multiplied by A1E divided by L1. That is how A1 plus A1E divided by L1. That is how, so please see that that element shiftness matrix 1 is contributing to this global shiftness matrix in this fashion. Along first row, second row, first column, second column only. It not contribute to the third degree of freedom, fourth degree of freedom, sixth, nth degree of freedom. But first element will contribute to the first row, second row, first degree of freedom, second degree of freedom only. Please make a note, right? Don't do any mistake, right? Therefore, it is contributing 0, 0, 0, 0 to the other degrees of freedoms in the row as well as in the column. Similarly, it is contributing 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, right? That is how you please make a note, right? Now, I think once you understood this, students, that first element shiftness matrix is contributing like this, then you go to the second element shiftness matrix, KE, right? This is having second row, second column is having a coefficient of A2 by L2 multiplied by 1. Therefore, you go to the second row, second column. Already at that location in that IP address, A1E divided by L1 is already there. Therefore, now you superimpose with this A2E divided by L2. A2E divided by L2, students, right? Therefore, now I do have A1E divided by L1 plus A2E divided by L2, because no 2 is a constant, combined for first element and second element, which is common for first element and second element. Therefore, at node 2, the stiffness contribution is also from the first element, A1E divided by L1, and also because node 2 is also common for the second element, it is taking contributions from the second element also as A2E divided by L2, right? I think once you understood that, you do in a similar fashion. You go to the respective IP address, right? Say 2, 3, minus 1, like that 3, 2, 3, 3, like that 3, 4, 3, 3, 3, 4, 4, 3, 4, 4, right? Like that, so on and so forth, right? Now, that is how they are just being superimposed here in this or they are just written here, right? That is how the contribution from the second element as A2 by L2 E minus A2 by L2 multiplied by E minus A2 by L2 multiplied by E, A2 divided by L2 multiplied by E, right? These are superimposed one over the other at second node. Like that, you if you do at the third node also, there is a superimposition in the form of A2 L2 plus A3 L3. Now, that is our superimposition. That is our the contribution from the third element, A3 by A3 E divided by L3 minus A3 E divided by L3 minus A3 E divided by L3 plus A3 divided by L3. I think if you do in a similar fashion, I'll go up to the last one, right? A4, right? Dash, dash, dash up to A5, A5. So that is of the last element stiffness matrix, which is contributing A5 E divided by L5 minus A5 E divided by L5 minus A5 E divided by L5 plus A5 E divided by L5. That is how in the IP address 6 by 6. This is there in the IP address 6, 6th row, 6th column. That is the IP address, right? That is how this capital K, which is called the structural stiffness matrix or global stiffness matrix. Global stiffness matrix, 6 by 6 matrices evaluated or written or derived, right? You please see that a few elements are coefficients are 0 here, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, right? That is even here 0, 0, right? Means there are no contributions from the other elements onto this element, right? That is all the meaning. And even you can now let us examine that what are the in a similar fashion, I'll try to assemble the global load vector also, right? I already know what is F1. Element body force vector is given by F A L divided by 2, 1, 1, 1. Therefore, for the first element, the element body force vector is given by F A1 L1 divided by 2, 1, 1. This is along the global IP addresses 1, 2. Similarly, in a cyclic fashion, we can say element body force vector for the second element is F A2 L2 by 2, 1, 1 along the global degrees of freedoms 2, 3. Right? In a cyclic fashion, you can write element traction force vector given by T L1 by 2, 1, 1 along 1, 2 IP address or global degrees of freedom. Element traction force vector T2 is T multiplied by T is a constant, right? Multiplied by length. Length is also constant. This is Newton per mm multiplied by mm or kg per centimeter multiplied by centimeter. That by 2, right? By 2 means half is contributed to first node, half is to the second node, right? That is how along the IP addresses or global degrees of freedoms 2, 3, 2, 3, right? Now, even there are a few concentrated loads also at different locations. Hence, next subheading, assembly of global load vector. Assembly of global load vector. F is nothing but summation over all such elements, summation of Fe, the summation of Te, the summation of Pi's, if any. Therefore, now I'll open here. This Fe is a 6 by 1 matrix vector because 6 degrees of freedoms are there, 6 forces must be there at the 6 degrees of freedoms. Maybe there may not be there, that's a different question. Fine. And so I'll open 6 rows and 1 column, only 1 column, right? Now, that column is having first the contributions from the element traction force vector F. Now, I'll go to this first term, F1. F1 is having, what is the term? F A1 L1 divided by 2. In the first row, it goes with this much of F A1 L1 by 2. Yes. I'm taking that F A1 L1 by 2. Yes, yes. In the second row also, it will go by the same amount. F A1 L1 by 2. Yes, that's already done, right? In the second row from the element body force vector, it leaves F A2 L2 divided by 2 in the second row as well as third row. You please see that the same is shown, right? The second row, it is throwing a contribution or giving to a contribution of F A2 L2 divided by 2 in the third row also, F A2 L2 divided by 2, so on and so forth. I think it is now continuous. in a similar fashion, you can write dash 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 up to the last element will contribute F A phi L phi divided by 2, F L phi A phi divided by 2, right? Up to nth row or last row, last row, right? Now, that is all the contributions. All these are from the element body force vector. Similarly, the contributions from element traction force vectors are, now you please see that the element body force vector F A1 L1 by 2 plus F A2 L2 by 2, because that node 2 is common for element 1 and element 2. It is getting the contributions from the two elements. Similarly, that node 3 is also common for second element and third element, so on and so forth, right? The fifth node is common, fifth node is common for fifth node is common for fourth and fifth element. Therefore, it is getting contributions from fourth and fifth elements, right? That is how the overlappings are, superimpositions one over the other. These are what the element body force vectors. Now I'll move to element traction force vector. In a similar fashion, I do have T multiplied by L1 by 2 at the IP address 1. Therefore, at the IP address 1, similarly, the same is there at the IP address 2. T L1 by 2. Similarly, you can see at the IP address 2, T LE by 2 multiplied by plus 1. T LE by 2 with plus 1. And at IP address 3, T LE by 2 is there, right? That is how this second node is getting contribution from the first element and second element, so on and so forth. I think it is self-explanatory. It is getting the contributions from other elements also, but last element, the last node, it won't get T LE L5 by 2. And likewise, if any concentrated loads are acting along the nodes 1, P1, along the node 2, P2, dash, dash, dash up to P5, P6, P6, last node, should also be added. Then this total result, contribution from the element body force vector plus contribution from the traction element traction force vector plus contributions from the concentrated load vector, is the total concentrated load along the first degree of freedom. Similarly, this is the, in the second row, total concentrated load, this summation is the total concentrated load acting at that node, displacing that node by an amount of capital Q2, right? That is how element body force vector is evaluated. Once this element body force vector is also evaluated, now let us see what are the properties of this element shiftness matrix, right? Then we already know, we have already just seen that the element, structural stiffness matrix, capital K, or global stiffness matrix, K, we already examined that it is a symmetric matrix, means Kij, the coefficient in ith row and jth column is equal to the same coefficient of that of the kj row ith column. Kij is equal to kji, that we already observed, right? That symmetry is already there. And the second property is that the size of the element capital K global stiffness matrix is n by n, where n is the total number of nodes or total number of degrees of freedoms. Both are same, because one dimensional element will have, each node will have one degree of freedom only. Hence, total number of nodes by total number of nodes, but rather it is better you say total degrees of freedom by total degree of freedom is the size of the capital K. And third property is that the diagonal elements are not negative. We observed that the diagonal elements are never negative. If the diagonal element is negative, then matrix inversion cannot be done, right? Matrix inversion cannot be done. Therefore, it leads to singularity. it leads to singularity, right? A solution cannot be obtained, right? That is, a diagonal element cannot be negative, right? And also we have seen in this capital K stiffness matrix that is of the symmetry Kij is equal to Kji, right? Or minus A1 by L1 is equal to minus A1 by L1, right? Minus A2 by L2, right? That is all, right? This is how the diagonal. You can see the diagonal matrix or diagonal coefficients are not negative. Never. They will never. If that is there, singularity will happen. Means inversion of K matrix cannot happen, right? But you please see that this minus A1 by L1 is already available here because of that rule. Kij is equal to Kji. Then in order to reduce the memory power of the computers and to lessen the processing time for the calculation or for getting the final solution, what now we'll do is we'll write this in banded form. That is what called banded form or banded pattern, right? What is a banded pattern means? I'll not remember this. I'll not ask my computer to remember this minus A1 by L1 because of that property, Kij is equal to Kji. I'll only ask my computer to remember this IP address K12. I'll not ask, remember K21 because of that symmetry, right? Like that for all others, right? Hence, if you don't want to remember that, then I'll say that, yes, I'll remember this A1 by L1 minus A1 by L1. Then I'll not remember this, but I'll remember K22. I'll not remember K12 I'll not remember K21 because of this property. I'll remember K22, K23. Then I'll only remember K33, K34, so on and so forth. Hence, it is going in a banded form. You can see that is of the band, right? These are the bandedness, right? That is how, or even if you take this total minus A1 by L1, A1 plus L1, like that, with respect to, it is with respect to the diagonal symmetry, then there is what called full bandwidth. Now, I'm trying to write that in half band fashion, right? That is how. Now, this capital K, another property is that, this capital K can also be written in a banded matrix format, banded pattern, right? Then if I want to write that in a banded fashion, what is its size? Therefore, now this shows that, now I'm writing that in the banded fashion, right? That K banded is equal to N multiplied by N bandwidth that A minus A1 A1 by L1 minus A1 by L1 minus A1 by L1 outside E, right? Similarly, contributions from the second element A2 by L2 minus A2 by L2 A2 by L2 over, right? That is how the contributions from the third and fourth, so on and so forth, right? Now coming to the top, the last one, they are now superimposing as A4 by L4, L4 plus A5 by L5 and A5 by L5, A5 by L5, right? I have already ended with the last 6 by, this is the 6, in the IP address case 6 by 6, 6 by 6, there is no further this one, hence I'll say that is equal to 0, that is equal to 0, right? Please see that I have come up to this. Right, that minus A1 by, I have come up to this. This is what last, right? 6 by 6, A5 by L5. Beyond that, there's no continuation, right? No continuation means I'll say 0, right? That is 0. That is how this is IP address 6 by 6, sixth row, sixth column. A5E divided by L5 with positive value, later onward. Zero means end of that capital K matrix. That zero indicates that end of the capital K matrix, right? And so that is how K is written in a banded fashion as six rows and two columns only. Previously K was 6 by 6 I need to allocate 36 memory allocations. Whereas if I write that in banded fashion, I'm just allocating 6 multiplied by 2, only 12 memory allocations to the computer for remembering these stiffness coefficients. Right? Students, I hope you are understanding. Right? So I'm reducing the memory remembering by the computer so that processing for the final solution is quickened, right? Then once I do that, then I'll now discuss what is the effect of this node numbering on this bandwidth or half bandwidth, right? That is the next subheading, right? Effect of the node numbering on the bandwidth. Now, half bandwidth is notated by NBW. For one-dimensional problems with two nodes, the half bandwidth, NBW, is given by the maximum difference of the degrees of freedoms of one element, like that for all the elements of that structure, out of all that, maximum plus one, right? Now, let us see, as an illustration, how to calculate half bandwidth for this small illustration. In terms of the node numbering done, as I say, the first node is 1 for this, right? Second node is 2, 3, 4, 5. This is node numbering, right? 2, 1 plus 1, 2, 3, 2 plus 1. That is why I'm slowly moving by one. As I'm moving to the right hand side, then I'll take first element. The maximum degrees of freedom difference is 2. Minus 1. That is how 2 minus 1 for the first element. Second element, Q3 minus Q2 means 3 minus 2. Its difference is also 1. Like that, you please go to third element, 4 minus 3. Fourth element, 5 minus 4. Sixth element, fifth element, 6 minus 5. Here, please see that all the elements are having a maximum difference of 1. Therefore, only 1 plus 1, 2. And so, how bandwidth if the node numbering is done in this fashion. In this fashion, you require only half bandwidth 2. But let us see, I'll give the node numbering in the haphazardous fashion. Means there is no rationality in node numbering. Yet I'll use that same maximum node numbering as a 6, right? Therefore, I'm just saying that first node is the first one. The next one is haphazardous manner, 6th node. The third one is the node number 2. The fourth one is node number 3. Fifth one is 5. The sixth node number is 4. That is how I have done in a haphazardous manner, students. Then what is effect on half bandwidth? Right? Then for the first element, the maximum degrees of freedom's difference is 6 minus 1 is 5. Right? That of the second one is 6 minus 2, 4. Right? Like that. For the third one, third element, 3 minus 2, bigger minus smaller. Don't do smaller minus bigger, right? For the fourth element, 5 minus 3, it is equal to 2. And for the last one, 5 minus 4 is equal to 1, right? Therefore, out of all these, we can see that the first element is having maximum degrees of freedom difference as 5. 5 plus 1 is equal to 6. Means, if you give node numbering in this haphazardous manner, without any rationality, like this 1, 6, 2, 5, 3, 5, 4, 3, 5, 4, then you are not saving any memory power there. Still, you are using 6 multiplied by 6. 36 memory allocations means, compulsorily 36 memory allocations must be allocated, then only the problem can be solved, right? That is of the meaning, right? That is of the effect of the node numbering, right? Therefore, this is what called the bad node numbering compared to that of this good node numbering. Why this is good node numbering? Because it requires only very less half bandwidth compared to that of almost the same, nothing reduction. We have started with 6, even you are not able to reduce even by one. Therefore, this is bad node numbering. That is how the scheme for the node numbering. I hope you are understanding, students. Then once we do this, I think we'll see what are the boundary conditions and how they need to be taken care in the further discussions in the next class. I think I'll conclude today's discussions. Okay, in today's video, we have seen what are one-dimensional elements, and basic element 1D, two-node element. There we have seen the shape functions, derivations of the shape functions, followed by the derivation of element stiffness stress strain relationships and stress strain relationship matrix BE, and followed by element stiffness matrix KE, and followed by element traction force vector TE, followed by the assembly of global stiffness matrix, right, leading to the structural stiffness matrix K, and assembly of global load vector F, and the effect of the node numbering on the memory allocations or on hub bandwidth, right? I think we'll conclude this session. Thank you, students. Thank you for your watching this video. If you like this video, please do click like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We will meet with another topic in the next video. Till then, bye-bye.